So welcome to this Introduction to Teamwork Part 3 video. This part is about intercultural communication and especially focusing on how to do this in a virtual setting. Sometimes it's said that the most important thing in communication is to hear what isn't being said. That's particularly hard in virtual communication and when we don't communicate face to face, because a lot of this kind of communication is what you see, how people are behaving, how they're looking, how they're gesticulating, and so on. Also, there can be miscommunication due to a number of reasons, especially in this international setting. First of all, the use of second language. Usually English is a second language for many of us as a means of communication, means that we are not as precise and we're not as confident in the language than in our mother tongue. We can have different learning and working styles. That might be a personal thing as well. And we can also have different personalities. And all these things match up with also cultural differences when it comes to international projects. Also, it's important to be aware that when people are speaking, it's often because there is something underlying or they have some underlying concerns, which might not be expressed in the words coming out of their mouth. So one is saying, yes, we can meet at 8 tomorrow morning. But one is thinking, I can't get up anyway, but I don't bother saying it because I know it will not happen. Then you have a miscommunication already there. One would say, listen to me, I'm very experienced, and feel that the others don't really understand anything. So maybe they just have different perspectives, maybe they just come from different backgrounds, but this is also a kind of miscommunication that happens when you don't want to listen to other people. Someone might be more shy, thinking, is it my turn to talk? Should I say something? And there might be someone who is thinking that because of their background, they are not seen as important as the rest. Combine that with someone being more forward and someone being more shy. And some will think, but maybe not say, if we don't follow the supervisor's suggestion, will he allow us to pass? So there can be a cultural difference here about the relationship between student and supervisor. That in some cultures, if the supervisor or the professor says something, then you have to do it because it is expected from you. And in other cultures, you are really encouraged to question what is said and challenge what is said by the supervisor. And if this is not outspoken, this can also be a miscommunication. And then there's all the personal things. He complains of my garlic, but he has coffee and carrots all the time. So that was a little bit about the miscommunication or examples of miscommunication that can happen in the group room. And the best way to mitigate this is really to be, especially when you have the intercultural setting and there can be so many thoughts behind which are not expressed, to really try to be explicit and express your thoughts. The code of conduct or the collaboration agreement is an important part of making the implicit assumptions and implicit thoughts explicit so you can discuss it and you can deal with it in your group. I have divided the questions into two parts, what I would call task strategies and what I would call process strategies. And task strategies is really about what you do. So how do you handle meetings? How do you handle deadlines? How do you handle responsibilities? And on the other hand, we have the processes, which is more about how you manage people. For the task strategies, I've listed a number of questions here, which I think are important to consider when making the collaboration agreement or the code of conduct. I will not go through them all because I would just be reading them aloud, but I think it's a good idea to take a look at the questions here. And when you're making your code of conduct, make sure that you have addressed all of them, or at least if there are some you haven't addressed, that you have chosen not to address them. Also, there are different opinions about what a leader is and what is the role of a leader. So if it was a classroom, I would ask, should a group have a leader? Some would say yes. Some would say yes, but it should be called something else because we want all to be equal, and some would say no. So having the discussion if a group should have a leader and also what the role of the leader should be is important. And when I'm saying the role of the leader, it's both what are the duties, but also what are how should he involve other people in decision making and so on. That's very, what are the duties, what are the responsibilities? Yeah, and this picture also demonstrates a different view on what a leader is. I don't think I have to explain the figure much more, the difference between the boss and the leader. When it comes to code of conduct, there is also questions to ask regarding the process strategies. And as before, I would just leave the questions here, but try to go through them when you are formulating your code of conduct or your collaboration agreement, because I think they will be really helpful to see if you have addressed those questions. And that was all for this short little presentation. The most important is actually the questions listed throughout the presentation. I hope they will be useful for you in establishing your collaboration agreements. Thank you so much for listening.